Hispania, beautiful name, all Parsis have beautiful names, but Hispania Bhandara, the name itself suggests, on the one hand, the origin of Parsis and their roots in India. Hispania, if I'm not mistaken, pronounced Isfahan. I have visited Isfahan. It's so beautiful, and the people of Isfahan are so proud of their city. They say Isfahan is Nasfe Jahan. Isfahan is half the universe. It's so beautiful. I met Mr. Bhandara, Isfahan Bhandara, when we both participated in India-Pakistan dialogue in November of last year. The first time I met him, but I had exchanged email and spoken also. Yes. Mr. Isfahan Bhandara, the son of a very dear friend of mine, late Leo Bhandara, passed away in 2008. He was also a member of National Assembly of Pakistan and a minister sometimes.
In Ziaul-Haq's
time. Yeah. Ziaul-Haq's time. And what is interesting is that Ziaul-Haq tried to Islamize Pakistan and introduced prohibition. And here was the owner of a brewery who was made a minister in his government. You know, between 1998 and 2004, when I was in the Prime Minister's office, every time your father came to India, he would meet me, and he used to come very regularly. And he was also close to General Musharraf.
Yes.
And close also geographically, because your house in Rawalpindi, just stones away from Musharraf's military headquarters.
Army House.
Army House. I introduced your father to our former Prime Minister, Mr. Vajpayee, and also Deputy Prime Minister Advaniji. And, you know, he became a kind of an unofficial messenger between Musharraf and Vajpayee. I especially remember meeting your father in Islamabad when I had accompanied our Prime Minister for the SAARC summit in 2004. And he introduced me to several prominent Pakistanis, including Ardeshir Khosji, what a scholarly columnist he was, a great representative of the Parsi community in Pakistan. Unfortunately, he also passed away
in
2012. I think that your father was really needed for many more years. His passing away was really untimely. He could have made a major contribution to bringing India and Pakistan closer, at least reducing the differences, both during the 10-year rule of the UPA and especially now. When Meenu Bhandara passed away, Khushwant Singh, he wrote a tribute. And I would like to quote a few lines from his tribute, very pertinent now. Every time Nehru came to India, he was to attend a conference or seminar on Indo-Pakistan relations. He put the Pakistani point of view to Indian audiences. He put the Pakistani point of view to Indian audiences. And back in Pakistan, he put the Indian reactions in articles he wrote for Pakistani journals, and he was a regular writer in Dawn.
Minu Bhandara was a true bridge builder
between the two nations.
With his going, that bridge has fallen.
Then Khushwant Singh continues to write,
"For me, Minu's death has been a personal loss. With all my Pakistani friends from my Lahore days, now resting in their graves, he was my last remaining link with a country I call my Watan, my homeland. That link has been snapped." This was Khushwant Singh.
Friends, Minu Bhandara, a Parsi, some of us might think that, you know, except Muslims, other minorities in Pakistan are not really Pakistani patriots. This is a perception that some of us have. But Minu Bhandara was a staunch Pakistani patriot. He was a great admirer of Jinnah. And very courageously, in 2007, he introduced an amendment to the Pakistani constitution, and he inserted a notice in Dawn newspaper. And I would like to quote a short notice, very courageous of him to introduce this amendment. He says, "Qaid-e-Azam's speech, that is Jinnah's speech of August 11, 1947, a constitutional amendment bill had been moved in the National Assembly, which purports to include the famous speech of the Qaid, all its salient features, as a substantive part of Article 2 of the Constitution. Click your support or email MP Bhandara, Member, National Assembly of Pakistan." What are these substantive features of Jinnah's speech? Well, Jinnah, in my view, is a highly misunderstood person, especially in India and also in Pakistan. His August 11th speech in the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan is truly historic, and if Pakistan had remained true to what the founder of Pakistan had said in that speech, history of Pakistan is very different and history of India-Pakistan relations are very different. And this is what Jinnah said in that speech: "If we want to make this great state of Pakistan happy and prosperous, we will have to work in cooperation. Forgetting the past." Please remember, he is speaking on August 11, 1947. Pakistan is about to be created 3 days later, and he says he is telling the people to forget the past, bury the hatchet. If you do that, you are bound to succeed. "If you change your past and work together in a spirit that every one of you, no matter to what community you belong, no matter what relations you have had with each other in the past, no matter what your color, caste or creed, all of you are first, second and last a citizen of the state with equal rights, privileges and obligations. If you accept this, then there will be no end to the progress Pakistan will make." He goes on to make the message even more explicit. "I cannot emphasize it too much. We should begin to work in that spirit. And in the course of time, all these angularities of the majority and minority communities, the Hindu community and the Muslim community, because even as regards Muslims, you have Pathans, Punjabis, Shias, Sunnis and so on, and among the Hindus, you have Brahmins, Vaishnavas, Khatris, also Bengalis, Madrasis and so on, all these angularities, minority, majority will vanish. Indeed, if you ask me, this has been the biggest hindrance in the way of India to attain freedom and independence. And but for this, you would have been free people long time ago. No power can hold another nation, and especially a nation of 400 million souls, in subjection. Nobody could have conquered you.
And even if it had happened, nobody would have continued his hold on you for any length of time but for this. Therefore, we must learn a lesson from this. What he says next, Jinnah, is something very important. He says, you are free. The people of Pakistan are free. You are free to go to your temples. You are free to go to your mosques or to any other place of worship in this state of Pakistan. You may belong to any religion or caste or creed that has nothing to do with the business of the state. This was Jinnah, August 11, 1947. Unfortunately, this speech of his is at variance with the constitution that came to be written, accepted, and which is why your father wanted to introduce this amendment in the constitution, saying that this substantive part of Jinnah's speech should become part of the constitution, so that minorities are protected, and not just minorities are protected, but Pakistan becomes a society that is tolerant. And that would have really paved the way for better relations between India and Pakistan. Friends, this morning I met Mr. Ismania Kundara at the hotel near the airport where he's staying, and he presented this beautiful and truly priceless book which he sponsored, and he has dedicated the book to his father. It's written by Maureen Lyons. It's titled The Kalasha of the Hindu Kush. The Kalasha tribe. The Kalasha is actually Kailash. It's a Kafir tribe living in the remote Hindu Kush valleys. And this author and the photographer, she has made Hindu Kush her home now. And it was so thoughtful of you to have sponsored this book and dedicated it to your father. And what I learned from this book is that is another facet of your father, that he used to visit the Hindu Kush mountains regularly every year just to take care of the Kalash tribe, who live a very secluded life, and he would help them in every way he could, both as a member of parliament and also as a philanthropist. Now this is really a case of one minority supporting another minority, and I thought that the Kalash tribe was a tinier minority. They number about 10,000, and I just now learned from you that the Parsis in Pakistan are only 1,400. You know, that reminds me of what Gandhiji said about Parsis, that in number they are beneath consideration. In number, Parsis are beneath consideration. But in caring, compassion, and philanthropy, they are beyond compare. We are going to discuss the condition of minorities in Pakistan. And of course, we also want to discuss how India-Pakistan relations can be improved. We in India keep revisiting the question of minorities in India. And right now, you know, someone who belongs to a very influential organization has just made a statement that there are no minorities in India, and all are culturally and DNA-wise, they're Hindus. I don't comment on that, but our constitution has very strong protection for minorities, and at your request I've prepared a set of documents, a about how our constitution protects minorities and the various schemes and programs that successive governments have had for the welfare of minorities. Friends, we are certainly going to have a very informative, educative discussion today to know about minorities in Pakistan and how both majorities there and majority here, minority there and minority here can work together to change history and India and Pakistan become good neighbors, friendly neighbors, living in peace. Thank you very much.